This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond Egg Studios Music here. And now that we're a good couple weeks past yet another Valentine's Day spent wallowing in crushing loneliness, I can safely say that the only good thing I got out of that holiday was a metaphor for the good music of 2007. Because, you see, the good music of this year was like a box of Valentine's Day chocolates. The good stuff was delectable and incredibly varied, but you get through all the good stuff very quickly and you're then left with nothing but walnut clusters and chocolate-covered raisins that look suspiciously like rabbit droppings. It's true that the majority of this year was not good, and the worst music of 2007 was some of the worst of all time. On the flip side, while there wasn't a lot of all-time great music this year, what good music we did have had a staggering variety to it. Very few songs on this list share the same genre, and I suspect that most disagreements you'll have with me over placements on this list will boil down to which genres you prefer over the other. So without further ado, let the disagreements roll. We're counting down. This first song has a really, 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 really stupid name. Okay, that's out of the way. Play it. I'm not gonna go into detail about why I like this song or anything. Instead, I think I'm just gonna read out loud a couple of actual lyrical passages from this song. And I want these words to make things right, but it's the wrongs that make the words come to life. Who does he think he is? If that's the worst you got, you better put your fingers back to the key. Let's do another. Been looking forward to the future, but my eyesight is going bad in these crystal balls. It's always cloudy except for when you look into the past. One night stand. Okay, one more. I only think in the form of crunching numbers in hotel rooms collecting page six lovers. As the author of a series of children's action-adventure novels, which are several hundred pages long each, the fact that this collection of literary refrigerator magnets became a top 20 hit hurts me on a deep emotional level. Trust me, if you want to have some fun, then go over to the Lyrics Genius page for this or any other Fall Out Boy song and watch it try to desperately make sense of the lyrics. It's pretty funny. And yet, despite this, this song still managed to reach number 10 on this list. Is this only because 2007 was a really bad year for music and my pickings were pretty slim and I was desperate for anything that had at least some sort of awesome rock edge to it, however inane the lyrics may be? Well, partially, but I would be lying if I said that I didn't unironically enjoy this song on at least some level. I guess Fall Out Boy's entire existence is just proof that if you have enough rock star swagger, you can really take anything and make it sound cool. In a bathroom, I can play baseball in. Keyword there being if. This is wrong. This song is so embarrassing and lame. The two artists who made this were at number 4 and 2 on my worst list. I'm sorry. Okay, before we get to the song proper, can we just take a minute to reflect on the fact that this was Akon's biggest hit this year? Away, Seriously, out of the half dozen songs that Akon shat out this year, including the two that went to number one, his feature on a Gwen Stefani song of all things was what gave him his biggest charting success. I suppose it does fit though. I mean, despite how successful he was, Akon was likely the worst artist in music this year, and it took the brilliant and slightly deranged mind of Gwen Stefani to finally discover the one thing that he was good for. Yelping at the top of his lungs like a puppy caught in a bear trap. I mean it with no sarcasm whatsoever when I said that his part on this song was the part that Akon was always meant to play. And you know what? It works. This is just another silly love song, but it has enough unique elements to help it stand out as a really fun track. First of all, there is Akon, who's doing great for once in his life. Second, there's the ska influence on this song, which is likely the only time that Gwen Stefani experimented with Jamaican-style music without embarrassing herself, both solo and with No Doubt. And then there's Gwen herself, who gives a Britney Spears-esque performance that fits the tone of the song quite nicely. I especially like the switch up from a triplet-based pre-chorus on the first verse to a more rigidly syncopated 8th and 16th note-based pre-chorus on the second verse. For those of you who don't speak music nerd, that's how this part flows differently from this part. I can see that you're angry by the way that you treat me. Hopefully you don't leave me. Wanna take you with me. So yes, this is objectively pretty lame, and yes, Gwen Stefani and especially Akon have both made far more songs that I dislike than songs that I like. But you know what? For this one brief, glorious moment in 2007, their collective breeds of insanity gave us the sweet escape. And amidst all the dated lameness of 2007, it was nice to hear one bit of lameness that's actually held up pretty well. Have you ever had a really crappy week where it seems like everything sucks and nothing can go right, but then one day that week you hang out with an old friend of yours and you don't actually talk about what's going wrong, but it just seems like, you know, just by being the awesome person they are, someone who you know so well and you're so comfortable and familiar with, you're just able to hang out with them and relax and have fun and just forget about all the crap that's going wrong in your life? Well, for me, 2007 was that week, and that friend was Pink. Pink is the best, and I will hear no word against her, except for when she's being boring and selling out, which unfortunately has been happening pretty frequently as of late. But 11 years ago, Pink was in her prime, and in the midst of the doldrums of 2007, it was absolutely fantastic to hear this song. Those punchy guitars sound fantastic, the song is drenched in Pink's awesome personality, and the entire song is built around one of the best Wham lines in pop history. I do have to admit though, I'm kinda curious how this song would be judged if it were released today. Because you see, there was this other song that got released a couple years ago which dealt with kinda similar topics and themes and, well, let's just say it received a significantly icier reception. My name is No, my sign is No, my number is No, you need to let it go. Yeah, if you think about it, the song is basically lyrically identical to No by Meghan Trainor. Both of them are essentially giant middle fingers to guys who are trying to hit on women at the club when they're not into it. And yet, one of these songs is a beloved classic, and the other one was reviled as one of the worst songs of 2016. Why is that? Well, I'd argue that part of it is because the social climate in 2007 was very different than what it is today, but that's a rabbit hole that I'm not willing to jump down at the moment, so we'll just put that aside. Instead, I'll just keep it simple and say that a large part of it comes down to presentation and personality. I mean, just compare these two sections from the songs. Thank you in advance. I don't wanna dance. Nope. I don't need your hands all over me. No, no. If I want a man, then I'ma get a man. But it's never my priority. Hey. We didn't get all dressed up just for you to see. Quit spilling your drinks on me, yeah. You know who you are. High five and talking. But you're going home alone, aren't you? 'Cause I'm Even though both of these songs are saying basically the same thing, for Megan, it comes off like she's deliberately trying to make a half-assed stab at a feminist anthem, which is bleedingly apparent throughout the rest of the song. Pink, meanwhile, is spending all her energy ripping hard into this guy, and we side with her because not only does she give more lyrical detail to the situation, but she's got such power and conviction in her voice that she's easy to root for. And I think that, more than anything else, describes the appeal of a lot of old Pink songs. She's able to stand up for what she believes in without necessarily coming off as confrontational or preachy, and she just seems like a genuinely cool person that you want to win. Her appeal definitely isn't this. So look, I came here to run it, just cause nobody's done it. Y'all don't think I've been running, but look, I've been here, I've done it. Come back, Pink, we still need you. It's just you and your hands and I. You know, legend has it that every time someone praises an R. Kelly song, a kitten gets diabetes. Eh, worth the risk. Messing with the same girl, same girl. How could the love of my life and my potential wife be the same girl? This song has kind of been lost to history, and honestly, it isn't completely unwarranted. This is a pretty goofy song, even bordering on being a novelty, if I'm being honest. But damn if it doesn't put the biggest smile on my face every time I hear it. Yo, what up, girls? Wanna introduce you to this girl? You see, the premise of this song is a simple one. I mean, hell, it's practically ripped straight out of a Happy Days episode. Just with some questionable racial slang thrown in there. You see, in the song, Kelly calls up his best buddy Usher and tells him about this wonderful new woman that's entered his life. The conversation starts out fine. Hold on, dog. Do she got a kid? Yep. She loves some Waffle House. Yep. Do she got a beauty mark on the left side of her mouth? Man. But as Kelly gives more details, Usher comes to a shocking realization. Man, I didn't know that you were talking about her. So man, you telling me you know her? Do I know her like a path to know it's where we messing with the same girl? Yes, Kelly and Usher have both been seeing the same girl without even realizing it. Oh, what a conundrum this is. So, how do they choose to react to this? Do they start yelling at each other? Do the accusations start to fly? Do these two former best friends turn on each other, vowing revenge for this horrible betrayal? Well, actually, their reaction is kinda more similar to this. Oh, man! Yes, in a truly inspiring demonstration of the bro code, these two guys have no animosity towards each other whatsoever. In fact, they talk about this girl for a bit, talking about the trick she used to seduce both of them, before finally deciding to get back at her by doing this. Call her up at her home, she won't know I'm on the phone. Yeah, man, that's the thing. Homie, we about to bust this trick. Man, just ask her to meet up with you, and I'm gonna show up too. And she won't know what to do. We'll be standing there singing, singing. This is just such a heartwarming display of friendship, honestly. Not for a second does it even cross their minds to get angry at each other. Even beyond the narrative, the theme of friendship between the two of them is even emphasized by slipping references to each other's songs into their verses. I thought it was true confessions when she said, I love you. Man, I thought her body was calling when she said, I want you. And you know what? In the end, it all works out, because it turns out that this girl was actually twins. Wait, what did I just say? And you know what? In the end, it all works out, because it turns out that this girl was actually twins. Oh, well, of course. Clearly with one of those common pairs of twins that have matching ankle tattoos, identical beauty marks, like the same type of food, went to the same college, have the same job, live on the same street, drive the same type of car, with the same license plate, and both have the same nickname. What an idiot I am for assuming otherwise. But frankly, other than that stupid twist at the end, the music video is great and perfectly matches the song, which I absolutely love. There are only two reasons this song isn't any higher on this list. The first is because this isn't a song that you just listen to any time, like some of the songs higher up. You need to be in a specific mood for it. And the second reason I can't fully endorse this song is because... oh god. She's the apple of my eye, and my potential wife. Yeah, nothing kills the mood for me more than when R. Kelly starts talking about losing a girl who is going to be his potential wife. Messing with the same girl. Usher, Buddy, Bro, Amigo, please, for the love of God, tell me that you are not into the same type of girls that R. Kelly is into. Because if you were, well, to put it kindly, let's just say you'd probably have to immediately start work on Confessions Part 3, if you catch my drift. However, as long as I disconnect the words from the person singing them, I do think that this song is pretty great, and I'm glad it managed to just barely scrape onto the year-end list. And the best part is, this review didn't even give one single kitten diabetes. In there right, Dusty. In there right. You really should have listened to what they said, Amy.
They tried to make me go to rehab. I said no, no, no. Yes, I've been black, but when I come back, no, no, no.
I'm not gonna say much in this entry. Honestly, this song is such a cult classic, there really isn't too much that I can add to the conversation. I mean, this song is basically the textbook example of an underrated gem that far too many people have forgotten. It's a throwback R&B jam by a ridiculously talented vocal performer who died tragically young, produced by the guy who made Uptown Funk. What more could I possibly add to that?
I'm gonna lose my baby.
Forget about the pop scene of 2007. This song would have stuck out like whatever the good version of a sore thumb is if it had been released in any year of the 2000s. In fact, I'd go as far as to say that had Amy Winehouse not died at the age of 27, she would be one of the biggest stars in the world right now, in a similar vein to her obvious successor, Adele, who has gone on record to say that Amy Winehouse was one of the biggest, if not the biggest, source of inspiration for her. But even then, with the possible exception of Rolling in the Deep, Adele has never produced anything as provocative as this. I guess that's just stylistic differences, though. Adele has never written about anything other than romantic struggles, and while she does that exceptionally well, it's hard to compare that to a full-on dive into the mind of a drug addict who knows that she needs help but doesn't know how to ask for it.
I'm not gonna spend 10 weeks. Have everyone think I'm off on the mat.
There's also the fact that, again, with the possible exception of Rolling in the Deep, Adele has never had to beat this good beneath her. This is Mark Ronson firing on all cylinders, creating a stellar throwback beat that somehow manages to be both pompous and restrained all at once. It really is a work of art. I especially like those bells that sound in the verses. They add quite a lot. This song really is a masterpiece, and the reason it's not any higher on this list is right down to pure, subjective opinion. While I do think that this song is technically better than some of the other songs I placed above it on this list, well, I don't know what to tell you, other than that there are other songs that I find myself returning to more often than this one. And to find out what those songs are, I hope you guys will tune in for part 2 of this list. Fair warning, I am going to be traveling to St. Paul for a little while to promote my book series, so part 2 might not be out for a little bit. But I promise to get it to you guys as soon as I possibly can, and so I thank you guys for understanding and being patient. I'm Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond Axe Studios, and I will see you next time. Take care.
So